want to welcome you. Thank you for joining us today. This is Progressive Church Community International Church. And I want to welcome you to the Word on Wednesday. It's an hour of power where we go through God's Word in depth, in detail, to find out exactly what He wants to the best of our ability. I want to thank Pastor Curtis again for giving me an opportunity to come before you again today. We will be reading out of Genesis chapter 46. We finally made it through Genesis 45. It was a lot of powerful things in chapter 45. And today we're going to start in Genesis chapter 46. And I will be doing verses 1 through 5. Again, we'll be in Genesis chapter 46, verses 1 through 5. So get your Bibles out so that you can read the scriptures along with us. And with that, I'd like to just start off in prayer, and then we'll go straight into the scripture, the lesson for today, for the Word on Wednesday. So, Father God, we give you thanks. Lord God, we give you praise. We thank you, Lord God, for your Word, Lord God. It's so powerful. It's helping us, especially in these times that we're living in, to see that the same issues that we go through in life are the same things that our ancestors went through when Jacob and Abraham and when Isaac were here and even when Noah was here. All of our ancestors, Lord God, we just thank you for their stories and for the humanness that you're showing, that they're human, but you still love them. In spite of their humanness, in spite of their mistakes, in spite of their failures, Lord God, you love them so much. And you care for them so much that you said, I will be with you. And so we thank you, Lord God, for your presence. And we thank you for your Word today. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Last week we talked about Jacob, how he had suffered for over 20 years and the attitude that he had about everything. And when his sons returned, he didn't really believe that Joseph was alive. But by the time everything transpired, when we got to the last verse, his name wasn't called Jacob anymore. It was called Israel because he had been revived. God had revived him to be the man of God that he had called him to be. Instead of walking in his flesh, he's walking in the spiritual man of him. Is more in tune to what the Spirit of God is saying in his life. So here we are in verse 46, verse 1. And what's happening is the people are going to Egypt. So the first scripture says, and Israel took his journey with all that he had and came to Beersheba and offered sacrifices unto the God of his father, Isaac. So in this scripture, there's a lot of meat in this one scripture. It says Israel, now his name is Israel in this particular verse, took his journey. The journey he is on is he's going to Egypt. He's going to Egypt with all that he had. And he's coming from Hebron because he pitched his tent. His family lived in Hebron. And on the journey to Egypt from Hebron, he stopped at Beersheba. Now, as he's traveling on this journey, to get from Hebron to Beersheba is about 26 miles. It takes about 416 miles for them to get to Egypt. So in 26 miles, Jacob, they stopped. They stopped at Beersheba. They had come from Hebron. And they're going, and they stopped at Beersheba, which is about 26 miles away. Beersheba is a place that was very special to the family. Abraham and Isaac, they both built altars in Beersheba. They stayed there for an extensive amount of time and they set up altars to the Lord. So here Israel is traveling to Egypt from Hebron, and he stops at Beersheba. Now, Hebron is on the southern part of Canaan. So it doesn't take long to get to Beersheba, and from Beersheba it doesn't take long to get into the very tip of the country of Egypt. But as he's on his travels, he's beginning to have a few doubts about this journey. He's leaving behind some very special places that he will not be able to see again. Hebron is close to Bethel. Bethel is north of Hebron, and he didn't even go through Bethel. But Bethel is the place where his grandfather, Abraham, pitched his tent. It's where his grandfather stayed and built an altar on his way to Egypt. It's where Jacob fled when he was trying to get away from Esau. And he had this dream of a ladder stretching to heaven and earth. And God was standing on the top and said, I'm going to give you all this land. It's going to belong to you and your people. So he's leaving all of this behind. It's the place where God changed his name from Israel to Jacob. I mean, from Jacob to Israel, excuse me. Also, he's leaving behind the ancestral tomb. Hebron is also close to Mamre, the place where all the patriarchs have been buried. Abraham and Sarah are there. Isaac and Rebekah have been buried there, and he won't be able to go and visit this place anymore when he goes to Egypt. So on his way to Egypt, he's thinking, he's having some doubts, he's having some second thoughts, and he returns to Beersheba. That's the place where he was born. Beersheba is where Jacob is born. It's also a place where his grandfather, Abraham, planted an orchard and built an altar and called on the name of the Lord. It's the same place where the Lord appeared to his father Isaac and promised to bless Isaac and to bless Isaac's seed for Abraham's sake. And Isaac pitched his tent there, and he dug a well, and he built an altar in that same place, Beersheba, and he called on the name of the Lord. So on his way to Egypt, Israel stops at Beersheba, and he calls on the name of the Lord. Beersheba is the place where his grandfather and where his father went when they weren't sure what they were doing. If they wanted to make sure that they were doing was in agreement with God's will. So on his way, he stops at Beersheba and he offers sacrifices to God. For he does this, and he's probably giving thanks. We know it doesn't specify, but as I was studying this, the Lord was speaking to me. So I'm just going to put the word probably in front of it. He was probably giving thanks to God for the return of his son Joseph. He knows Joseph is alive. He was probably asking God to meet with him on this journey, to give him some insights of making sure that he's doing the right thing. He's pouring out to God his fear. as well as his gratitude and his joy. And he's placing himself and his family under the shelter of God's care. He's giving sacrifice. He's praising God. He's worshiping God. He's praying to God to confirm to him the covenant that he had with Abraham and Isaac, that is really on him, that he's really going to get this covenant. And on top of that, he's having second thoughts about the journey. He's thinking about sending Joseph and saying, "Joseph, you come to me. I don't know if I really should be going down to Egypt. I'm not sure." Because he remembers this prophecy that was given to Abraham back in Genesis chapter 15. And the prophecy God said to Abram, because his name wasn't Abraham then, God said that you can know for sure that your descendants will live in a land that is not their own, where they will be slaves and they will be oppressed for 400 years. So Jacob is thinking about these things. So he goes to Beersheba, a place, a spiritual place where we go when the events of life call us to call upon the name of the Lord.
Yes.
The Bible doesn't tell us how long he sacrificed at Beersheba, but the historical records tell us that he stayed there for 7 days. And he stayed there because he wasn't sure if he should remain in Canaan, the land of promise, the land that was given to him and his generations. And now he's going to Egypt, which is a place that is not his manner, a strange land that is not theirs. And after he praised and worshiped and sacrificed and spent quiet time waiting on God to speak to him, it was time for him to celebrate the harvest of first fruits. So here we are in Canaan. It's in the middle of a famine. And Jacob Israel goes out and he harvests only a handful of old grain. Now this is from historical books, historical Hebrew books. He harvests a small handful of old grain from the land, because the first fruits festival means that you have to harvest the fruit. And all he could get was a handful. And the grain was old because of the famine. The famine is on the land, it's on the animals, it's on the plants, it's on everything. And all he could get was a handful, but he still did the festival of first fruits. And then as he went to sleep that night, in the wee hours of the night, the day after the celebration of first fruits, the Lord appeared unto him and said unto him, "Jacob, Jacob." And he said, "Here am I." So in verse 2, what I just gave you was from historical books. Now I'm going to go to the Bible. The second scripture says, "And God spake unto Israel in the visions of the night and said, Jacob, Jacob. And he said, Here am I." Now when I first saw this lesson, I said, "Man, you know, went back again to acting a nut," because that was my first thoughts. But God had to correct my thinking of what was going on in this passage. This man has been praising God and worshiping God and sacrificing to God. He's looking for an answer. He's just not sure. So God spake unto Israel in the visions of the night. He appeared to Israel as he lay upon his bed at night, and with an articulate voice, he heard the voice.
Yeah.
God, the Lord said, Jacob, Jacob, not Israel, not the name of honor that God had given him, but Jacob. The Lord said, Jacob, Jacob, he said, Jacob, to put him into remembrance of his former self, the lower state that he used to walk in before he was revived and became Israel, before that revival that we saw in the last chapter. He wanted to him to remember that he used to walk in the world.
Yeah.
What's the scripture in 1 John? For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. Jacob walked in that. And then the Lord said, Jacob, Jacob, he doubled his name. Okay, he doubled his name. I read one time where God said, Moses, Moses. He said, Samuel, Samuel. He doubled their name out of love, out of affection, to wake them up, to stir up their attention, so that they could hear what the Lord is about to say to them. So when you, if you ever hear the Lord call out your name, Janice, Janice, he wants you to wake up, to get your attention, because he's about to say something powerful in your life. He's trying to stir up your attention so that you can hear what he is about to say to you. And Jacob said, here am I. In other words, I'm going to say Jacob because God called him Jacob at this point. Jacob is saying, I'm demonstrating my eagerness, Lord God. I'm ready to listen to what you're about to reveal to me. I want to obey you in whatever you tell me to do. Because he's been worshiping and praising and looking for God to give him an answer for days. But he didn't hear anything until after he did the harvest of first fruits. And then the Lord spoke, and he said, I am God, the God of thy father. Fear not to go down into Egypt, for I will there make thee a great nation. He said, I'm the Lord God. He's his father Isaac. He said, I'm the Lord God of your father. His father Isaac has made his transition. But God has said, I'm the Lord of your father. Okay? And because of your father, you are going to receive the blessing that I made, the covenant that I gave to Abraham that passed to Isaac and now is passing on to you. Because of your father. I am God, the God of your father. I am the God of your father, true to the covenant that I made with him and his generations. You know me to be a God of divine wisdom and power, and I am engaged for you and for your generations. See, this is a confirmation of a covenant relationship that God has with Jacob Israel. I'm using both names because he's still called Jacob here. God decrees and declares that he is the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. He decrees and declares that he will perform whatever he promised. Whatever he promised to Abraham, whatever he promised to Isaac, he's going to do for Jacob and for his generations. God decrees and declares to show Jacob his favor as, you know, as he's in Egypt and on his journey. And God says, fear not to go down into Egypt. See, Jacob, when Jacob first found out that Joseph was still living and that there was abundance in Egypt, without any hesitation, he decided to go and see his son. But later, as he did them first 26 miles, he started to have some second thoughts. He saw the difficulties. He's 130 years old. It's a long journey. He only did 26. He got 390 more to go. He was unfit for travel. He's an old man now. And maybe the journey was too great for him. Or maybe some evil would happen to him. He didn't know. He wanted to make sure that he was in God's will. Maybe he would die on the way because of his age and him not being fit for travel. And then other things came to him as he was in prayer and praise and worshiping God. His sons are going into Egypt, and maybe they will be contaminated with the idolatry in Egypt, or forget that God is their father, that God is the God of their fathers. And then he kept thinking about that prophecy that God gave Abraham concerning slavery and afflictions for the generations to come. And then he couldn't think about his bones being laid in the grave in Egypt. He wanted his bones to be laid in Mamre, in the cave, in the tomb of the patriarchs. He couldn't think about his bones being there. He wasn't sure if this journey was agreeable to the will of God. See, his father Isaac was forbidden to go to Egypt. And it was a similar circumstance in the time of famine. There was a famine in the land. It was one during the time of Abraham as well. So Isaac went to Abimelech of the Philistines. And the Lord appeared to Isaac and said, don't go to Egypt. So he's thinking about, his father was told, don't go to Egypt. He's thinking about, Abraham said, your people are going to be in slavery. They're going to be in captivity for 400 years down in Egypt. And he's wondering if he is the one that's supposed to take his people to Egypt. If he is out of God's will, if he gets off track in his mission, then maybe his family might be tempted with the appeal and the abundance in the land and settle there and forget and neglect the promise that they have with the land of Canaan. But whatever his discouragements were, it was enough when God said, fear not to go down into Egypt. See, this is the dawn of a new beginning,
right,
for Israel and his family.
That's right.
He said, for I will there make thee a great nation. And God did. He made them a great nation in Egypt. See, where they were in Canaan, there was too much influence. Too many different religions and cultures and thoughts. And they were impacting Jacob and his family. You know, when they went to Shechem and all these other things that happened to him, and Simeon and his brother killed all the people, and Judah acting crazy about his daughter-in-law, all that kind of stuff going on. But that's because they were in a land that had a lot of different religions, a lot of idols, a lot of different schools of thought. And God had to separate his people. He had to put them in a place where he could separate them from the land so they can grow into a nation. So he sent them to Egypt. Why Egypt? Because Egypt, they were separatists. And they would not interfere with the growth and the birth of the nation. Yeah, they like you. Okay, as long as you stay in your spot, you cool. Stay in motion. Do your shepherding stuff, whatever y'all do over there. That's cool with us. Long as we keep on getting this food and everything y'all provide for us, we cool. Y'all do y'all thing over there. We're not going to interfere and intervene on the nation's growth in Goshen. See, when you think about it, started with Abraham and getting to Jacob and his family, it took 215 years from Abraham having Isaac to Jacob having his family. 215 years to get 70 people. So at the time that they go down to Egypt, it's only 70 people going down into Egypt. Just 70. That's it. But as they grow in Goshen, as they're isolated and can do their religious duty to God, the Lord God, their Lord God, the Hebrew God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, they're able to grow into a nation. So by the time Moses comes along to bring them up out of there, it's 600,000 men. That's just the men. That didn't count the women, and that didn't count the children. And you can find that in Exodus chapter 12, verse 37. So four generations of Abraham's children, they suffered in Egypt when God heard their cry. But I know that's a different part of the story. In the next verse, God said, I will go down to Egypt with you, and I will surely bring you up again, and Joseph shall put his hand upon thine eyes. In other words, he's saying, I'm going to go with you. That was enough to silence Jacob's fears.
Amen.
For when the presence of God goes with him, he's going to protect him, defend him, hide him, bless him, prosper him, direct him, comfort him, support him, and he had nothing to fear from anything. For those that go where God sends them shall certainly have God with them. So if God tells you to go somewhere, you know his presence is going to be with you, then you go. Don't worry about what's going to happen.
That's right.
Don't worry about the things that Jacob was going through in his head. Don't worry about those things because God is with you.
Amen.
And no weapon formed against you will prosper.
Amen.
And then he said, I will surely bring you up again. Now that's a twofold promise.
Amen.
Okay? It's a promise for Jacob as the man, and it's a promise for Israel as the nation. First, this is a promise to Jacob that his bones won't be buried in Egypt, that his family will bring his bones and bury them in the cave in Mamre, where the tomb of the ancestors are. And this was fulfilled when his body was carried out of Egypt. And his body was entombed with Abraham and Sarah and Isaac and Rebekah. But then the other part of this promise is for the nation of Israel, because God will bring his children out.
Amen.
He's going to bring his seed out of the land of Egypt to be settled in the promised land of Canaan. So wherever we go, if God goes with us, he will surely bring us back again.
Amen.
If the Lord goes with us down to death, he will bring us up in eternal life.
Amen.
That's his word. If God goes with you, if you know God before you leave this world, God will bring you back up.
Amen.
in eternal life. So whatever he tells you to go, you go. Whatever he tells you to do, you do. Don't have any doubt. Don't have any fear. If you have doubt, do like Israel did. Go into prayer.
Yeah.
Go into some meditation. Read some word. Worship him. Praise him. Show him that you need to hear a word from the Lord. That's what Israel was doing just in that first verse alone.
Yeah.
He was offering his sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. He was giving his concerns to the Lord his God.
Yeah.
And then in the last part of that scripture it says, and Joseph shall put his hand upon thine eyes. What he was telling Jacob is, when it's time for you to die, it's going to be your son, Joseph, who will close your eyes. See, in the days of Jacob, this was a custom of the living to the dead. A close relative, when you passed away, would close your eyes. That's not so in these days, but back in those days it was. In other words, just by him hearing this, the Lord is telling Jacob, assuring Jacob that Joseph was alive and that he will live to see him and that Joseph would outlive him, because that was another concern that he had, and that he would do whatever he had to do to help the children of Israel be who they were called to be.
Amen.
In other words, Joseph was going to remain behind to sustain, to support Jacob's children and his children's children and his children's children's children after him.
Yeah.
This was good news.
Yeah.
For Jacob. So after hearing all of that, Jacob rose up from Beersheba, and the sons of Israel carried their father and their little ones and their wives in the wagons which Pharaoh had sent to carry him. In other words, Jacob rose up from Beersheba. Yeah, he only made it 26 miles, but now he's refreshed. He's in high spirits. He's going to proceed on the journey. He's encouraged by the promises that God has made to him, what God has said to him. And the sons of Israel, let me back to Israel again, the sons of Israel, his sons and his son's sons, carried Jacob their father. In this scripture, I noticed that there was no mention of Jacob's wives or his daughter. It mentions the son's wives and the son's children, but it doesn't mention Jacob's wives. And that's probably because they had passed away. They're probably already in the ancestral burial plot. We know that Rebecca died in Genesis chapter 35 in childbirth to Benjamin.
Right.
He doesn't really say about Leah, but when you read it in chapter 49, Israel says, I buried Leah in the tomb. Well, he had to do that before he left. So that means that Leah had already also passed away. You know me, if you know anything about me, anytime I find something like that in scripture, I got to go study, trying to figure out what happened, where are they, what happened. And I'm going to share this, and I share history because it helps me to understand.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it will help you or not, but it helped me to understand. But this is history, it's not scripture, it's history. I want to make that well. So in history, it says that We know in Bible, Rachel made her transition in Genesis chapter 35. We also know that Leah, based on what Jacob said when he buried her in Genesis 49, that she was there. But it didn't say anything about Bilhah or Zilpah or Dinah. So I started looking up and I went to some historical books. And the historical books state that when the brothers returned from Egypt the first time and told that, when the brothers returned and told that lie that Jacob had been dead, they had been in Egypt yet. When they returned, they had killed the goat, put the blood all over his coat, and told his father that Joseph was dead. Bilhah, his nurse, which is Rachel's nurse, she died immediately. She couldn't take the fact that Joseph had died. And then Dinah grieved so hard, she also died. So according to history, when the brothers did that deed, both they were mourning Joseph, now they're mourning Bilhah, and they're mourning Dinah. So within 1 month, they're mourning three people based on a lie that Joseph was dead. Now that's history. It's not in our scriptures. But I thought that that was interesting. And if you're interested in the history books, you can find it in Jubilee and the Ledgers of the Jews. Now Zilpah, for some reason, they didn't talk too much about her. I couldn't find her anywhere. But I do know I did find one place that said tradition, Jewish tradition, that Zilpah is buried in the tombs of the matriarchs, because they got a matriarch tomb and they got a patriarch tomb. Okay. So they do believe her to be in a, because she is the mother of two of the sons of Gad and Asher, two of the sons of Jacob. And they also, in the historical book, it says that Leah died when Jacob was in Hebron when he was 106 years old. So in the historical books I found some more information, but like I said, it's not in our scriptures, and I want you to be aware of that. But let me get back on track. Amen. So they carried their father and their little ones and their wives in the wagons which Pharaoh had sent to carry them. So in Beersheba, after Joseph has been encouraged and refreshed, he restarts the journey. And they took all their livestock and their goods, which they had acquired in the land of Canaan, and they went to Egypt. Jacob and all of his descendants with him, his sons and his sons' sons, his daughters and his daughters' daughters, and all the descendants that he brought with him. He brought them with him to Egypt. And then as I was reading the rest of the scripture, they started naming people's names, so I just stopped. I'm just going to be honest. The next verse started naming all the descendants. These are the sons of Reuben, and these were the sons of Simeon, and these were the sons of this, and Leah had a daughter. They were naming every descendant of Jacob they named, because they want, even the ones that were dead, like Judah's two sons that first died before the issue with Tamar, that even their names were listed. So with that said, I'm going to open up for questions about the lesson. Because I'm just going to be honest, when I first got the lesson, I was like, this man is going back in the field. What's wrong with him? He just been revived. God had told him he know his son alive. Now he back in the flesh again. That wasn't really it. After God worked with me a little bit, he showed me that this man went into prayer. He went into worship and praise. He was unsure about his walk and what he should do, and he was looking for guidance from the Lord his God. And so he stopped at Beersheba. the place of his birth to get the answers that he needed so he could continue the journey, the other 390 miles he got to go to get to this land of Egypt. Any questions, anybody?
Did he get the answers he was looking for?
Yes, he did. God said, I'm going to be with you. You can, don't be afraid to go, because he was afraid to go. I'm too old. You know, I'm too old. I can't make it. I already did 26 miles, and I'm tired. I look at myself. I'm old. You make me walk 4 blocks. I'm like, look, I'm tired now. I mean, my feet don't work right as it is. You know, I got to walk a little weird because of how my feet go. And you got me walking 4 blocks, and now you're telling me to run? Let me sit down for a minute and get my breath. So he's 130 years old. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he in a caravan, being probably pulled by camels. I don't know what this been pulled. It's not like being in a car. Mm-hmm. And he didn't do 26 miles. Mm-hmm. I don't know how many days that took. That's probably a long time for a man 130 years old to be in a caravan going to Egypt. Mm-hmm. But yes, God answered him. He said, don't be afraid to go. I'm going to be with you. I'm going to be ever present with you. And I'm going to assure you that Joseph, he's going to outlive you. So you don't have to worry about your children or your children's children. So he gave him the answer that he wanted. Any other questions? Does anybody have something that they want to add? Because I always believe that God doesn't give one person everything. There's insights that other people have that I don't have. So if anybody wants to add something or, again, have a question, the floor is open for that.
There's two things. I think I'll forget one before, but in fact, I always chuckle when this God calls the name twice. So pay attention. Just pay attention. This relates to physical touch. It kind of popped in. It's like, if you have to call somebody on the radio on a construction site, and it's very noisy because you're doing work, and sometimes it's really noisy. Someone early days kind of told me, you need to say the name and then say the name again, because they might have thought they heard it, but then, because there's so much other stuff going on. In this case, there's a lot of stuff going on internally in him. So there's a lot of stuff going on. He got to make sure that, one, that he hears them pay attention. So maybe that's all. And this is related to the things. Haven't we all been a place where is it me talking, or are you talking to God? Is it just my thoughts and I think this is a good idea, or is it yours? We've all needed that place, haven't we? Am I the only one?
No, you're not the only one.
And sometimes reaches you in a place that there's no doubt about it. You couldn't have come together like that in the real world. That way you know you're short. Maybe somebody else would still have their doubts. Who cares about what anybody else thinks about whether you're short? The fact of the matter is, on an individual basis.
Yeah, God spoke to you.
I spoke to you.
And you know.
I know that you would know this is me talking
to you.
I'm sorry. That comes, and I've always was like, I like to try to think that God's talking to me like a whisper, like what I call as a spider web pull from my heart.
Mm-hmm.
But I said, everyone says, God, if you need to take the 2x4 out, please do it. And so it's like, oh, yeah. And I don't like that, but
he will do that too if he has to.
Obviously, I'm not hearing you. You need to hear that too. A Maggie.
Anybody else? Thank you for that.
If Jacob didn't go, he would make the black.
If Jacob didn't go, he would have been out of God's will. If Jacob didn't go, they wouldn't have grown into the nation that they were supposed to grow into. They would have been influenced like they had been in Canaan, mingling with other people, serving idols. if you keep reading in the Bible, eventually, if you read in the prophets, where they sort of fell off by the wayside, and they're serving other idols and gods and sacrificing their children and doing stuff that all the other people are doing, they would have probably done that sooner. They wouldn't have been able to grow into the nation that he wanted them to be. They wouldn't learn all, they wouldn't have had the priests helping them to be the men and women of God that they should be. They would end up worshiping, like I said, other gods in Canaan, because they had issues in Canaan. All throughout Genesis, we've been talking about the issues that they had in Canaan, things that they did and the doubts that they had.
I would say they probably also would have, because there was still a famine going on, and who knows if the allotment of food and resources would have continued if he didn't go.
That is so true.
It was possible death by staying. Yeah.
That is true.
Yeah. So I think they were forced in a way to go where God wanted them to be.
Amen. Thank you for that, Pastor.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody else?
Thanks for looking up all the history part.
That's just how God wires me. Sometimes I share it, sometimes I don't, but I just felt that I would share it this time because it sort of helped me to get the right idea of what was going on with Israel in the first verse, because I was like, this man in fear. I'm through with you. I got mad at him. But then when God directed me into the prayer and worship and praise and time of just calling on his name, then I understood. We all go through that. We all have times where we just have to get by ourselves and just pray. Don't bother me. Let me pray to God. I got to hear a word from God. He might not give it to us right away. He might wait 7 days like he did with Jacob. But he got the answer that he needed.
Amen.
So with that, if there's no other questions, I'm just going to say I thank you guys for coming. If you're in Facebook land, I want to thank you all for joining us. And before we leave, we always ask the question, do you know Jesus Christ? Do you know the Lord for yourself? Because it's not based on whether your mama go to church or your father go to church or your grandmother go to church or she made you go to church. The things have you confessed and believed and repented on your own? Have you accepted the Lord as Savior for yourself? If you are one of those who have not, or maybe you just want to just reaffirm your faith, just say this prayer with me, bow your head. Father God, I thank you, Lord God. I do believe in Jesus. I believe you sent him here to save us. I believe he came. I believe he died. And I believe he rose again so that we can be saved. I am saved, Lord God, because I have confessed with my mouth that the Lord is the Savior of my life. Amen. And now, Lord God, help me to live the rest of my life with him as Lord of my life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
If you prayed that prayer, I want to welcome you into the kingdom of God and write this day down. Write the date down. Because this is your new birthday.
Amen.
A day that you became a child in the kingdom of God. I want to thank you all for joining us. Come back again next Wednesday for the Word on Wednesday. We'll be looking forward to hear what the God has to say to the church next week. Amen. Have a blessed day, everyone. Thank you.